Let's get some more thoughts on this. Mal Fletcher is a social commentator. Good morning, Mal.
Good morning, Lisa.
And what are your thoughts on this?
Well, it's very interesting listening to the previous speakers there. I think the push for assisted dying as a principle is driven by compassionate motives. There's no doubt about that. But good intentions don't necessarily make good public policy. And what may seem best for an individual is not necessarily in the best interests of society in the long term. I think what we're talking about here isn't simply a change in a law. It's a major realignment of a basic cultural value. This notion of the sanctity of life is a cultural moire that's bestowed great strength on our civilization. And if you look at history, you find whenever a tolerance for killing of its own citizens has crept into a great society, human values have often been undermined eventually, and social structures have been weakened. I also think, Lisa, that politicians are not necessarily giving enough thought to the impact of present decisions on future generations. If, for example, we allow assisted dying today, will we allow involuntary euthanasia in 20 years from now? Now, that may seem like an hysterical thing to say, but the very same quality of life arguments used today by advocates of assisted dying have been used to support involuntary euthanasia, and that's something none of us would want to see. So I think we need to have a much longer debate, a wider debate outside of the Westminster bubble on what it actually means to give people the right to die.
So, Mal, you feel if this bill did get passed that it would just pave the way for more?
I think it's possible. I think the possibility needs to be taken into consideration. And the other thing that's important is that we hear a lot about the fact that people are in unbearable pain when they request help to die. But actually studies in areas of the world where assisted dying has been on the statute books for some time, areas like the Netherlands, these studies have shown that it's emotional trauma very often, not so much unbearable physical suffering. It's the fear of what may happen in the future that drives people to request assisted death. And so the laws would have to be dealing with highly subjective areas of psycho and emotional pain. And that's very difficult. Those charged with administering and interpreting those laws would then have to decide when it's appropriate for an individual to act on fear. And when would they be considered to be debilitated? Would it be after 6 months, 2 years, a year? Would it be legal for someone to set up a contract to die, is what I'm asking. How would those new laws define debilitation? What's debilitating for one person may be manageable for another, especially if they're given the right palliative care.
So, Mal, what about those people who really have reached the end of the line? They feel they've got no further to go. They can't give any more. You know, they really, really want to end their lives. Shouldn't those people be given that right?
Well, I think we have to always balance rights against, if you like, responsibilities or the message that we send to the wider society. I ask the question, what message are we sending our children and our young people when we tell them that under certain circumstances their best hope in life may be death? There are heroic stories emerging all the time of people young and old who beat the odds. They're not necessarily ridding themselves of disease, but they're refusing to cower in its shadow, a bit like Professor Hawking has done. They refuse to surrender their long-held dreams. And that unwillingness to go quietly, that commitment to leave a legacy of hope, is something that we celebrate, and I think we ought to celebrate. I'm not sure that acting in the interests of the individual in every case is what is necessarily good for society as a whole.
I've just read something about a recent poll, Mal, that suggests that 70% of us would back this bill. Do you think that's something that we say lightly? Are we not aware of the arguments, or do we genuinely want this bill to be passed?
Well, I think there's lots of things that feed into that. The first one is, as I said earlier, I think the debate hasn't really been an open debate. What we hear most often is the emotional side of the argument in the public marketplace. We don't hear the side that deals with the future of society, the future, what it means to law, what it means to relationships, what it means to civilization, what it means to our attitudes to life generally. It's very emotion-driven, which is not a bad thing, but it shouldn't be the only thing we consider in this debate. Secondly, I think that feeding into that is our natural fear of either death or debilitation. We all have that concern as we get older, and I think that feeds into it as well. But the other thing we need to look at too, I think, which is a totally different side that I don't know is talked about too much, is the fact that while advocates of this law will say that assisted dying should only be carried out in government-run, publicly-owned facilities like hospitals by accredited professionals, I think that it won't be long before private profit-seeking sectors to try to find a way in. in the sense that Digitas has in Switzerland. So you have profit-making industries devoted to ending life eventually. And
But that's not part of the bill at the moment. That's something that you fear could happen, yeah?
It's something that could happen if... You know, I know people scoff at the idea of thin end of the wedge arguments, but sometimes they're valid. If there's a healthy income to be made from trading on the promise of a comfortable death, and who doesn't want a comfortable death, then we should know that somewhere along the line the free market will try to step in, and that won't necessarily be a healthy thing for society.
Can you envisage a time, Mal, where we have Dignitas-style clinics popping up across the UK?
I do. If this bill and others like it, others to follow it, are given credence and allowed through, I do see a time when the private sector begins to play a greater role in people's decision to end their lives. And that's when I think we get into very, very murky waters.